Hi everybody and welcome to this session. I am very glad to introduce Verena Kvader from Paul Smith University of London and University of Huddersfield. And her presentation, Hollywood Flatlands, Taking a Line for a Walk.
This is a three-fold image lecture titled Hollywood Flatlands, Taking a Line for a Walk. First, fold one, a flow of images which correspond to an unread lecture script. Fold two, sound by Michael Karikis, which corresponds to a discrete conversation based on notes sent to him in preparation for the presentation. Sound and image form two heterogeneous elements without setting up a hierarchical relationship. Two voices, two rhythms, affective, sensual, fluctuative. Form three, a score produced from the screen.
Thank you.
the light of this idea of the line, at some point there was a charge with some explanation about the difference between the line seen as a line that goes between points and the line that in a sense is kind of projection of a moving point, if I got it right, in a non-Euclidean space versus. I was wondering, since some of the images you showed have a very strong connection with the moving images of cartoons, of movies, and so on, if there is a role that is played between this display of still images and their references to the fact that they are in motion, if there is an implication of this projection of the still image in the continuous space of the cartoon or of the movie. Can you have some comments?
Maybe if I go back to the actual image. So basically, this translation of the lecture I give, a paper, so a complete paper written, but translated into images. So there is a text which is missing here, in a way. So my lecture, or my talk, the text, the actual authority or institution, so to speak, is missing here. And this particular section, where you refer to, is a diagram by Thomas Lamar. Mm-hmm. He's a Canadian film media theoretician, works on Asian cinema, movie image material, and he discusses the Japanese manga, Japanese anime, in relation to the notion to Eisenstein's concept of the elastic line. And he makes this differentiation between the plastic line and the structural line, and discusses the animated line as something very peculiar and different to a structural line, where the center of the motion is within its punctual, so to speak. In that sense, it provokes any kind of notion of Euclidean geometry or space in a way. it's a bit more complicated concept to fully explain, but there is a differentiation made between the plastic line as in animation and the structural line, which is what we normally see as a normal line, so to speak, not having brought to life. And in relation to Deleuze and Guattari, if that comes up, of course, Deleuze and Guattari have worked on the line, and in particular, I'm more interested in not so much the point between the lines or the line between the points, which is quite a valid statement they made, but more in the chapter by Parnay and Deleuze, how they write on the political line, the social line, in the book. On the line. But at the moment I'm much more interested in Guattari's thinking about ecosystem in relation to animation as a material agency. And that maybe is also something that drives this decision to show images rather than text, so to speak, to let the things speak, or again to remove oneself from this authorial voice of subject. Things have power on their own, so to speak, to express it.
And I'm having trouble putting my question in my image to be on the level of your presentation.
You can talk.
I'm willing to make a compromise and ask the question in words. I'm just interested by the title Hollywood Flatlands, and the thing that made me think of was the
book Flatlands, which is an attempt, I think is an attempt to describe the difference between, to describe four-dimensional space by talking about two-dimensional creatures who discover a third dimension. And so I was wondering if that's what it was related to, and what the book about.
Not really. It's a reference to Esther Leslie's book, Hollywood Flatlands.
Oh, right, okay.
She writes on, it's one of the most probably the arena for everyone who wants to work on fine art narration, if you like, where it's grounded in early abstract film.
Okay.
So she discusses basically the history of this early abstract film, also through Walter Benjamin's, through how children look at the world, and this notion of utopia as it is embodied in that. But it's a clear book reference to her.
Okay.
So maybe a homage.
Yeah.
What's the relationship between the sound and the image?
Good question. I would see it as a parallel material, if you like. It was, again, for me, more testing out of Heidberg's, if you put a more foreign material with the lecture, the setup lecture, so to speak. So bring in another voice, if you like, but also an invisible subject yet again. And just see how those materials interview with each other, maybe are controversial to a degree, or how they complement accidentally each other.
So you wouldn't say it had the same kind of content?
Sorry?
So would you say, in terms of relation to content?
The content is more subtle, I would think, because I asked Mikhail Tarikis, he's a sound artist, performer based in London, and I asked him because of his engagement with the body as well, and his own thinking and work as an artist. And he responded to what I wanted, so to speak. He sent me three tracks, and I chose one of it. So he responded in his own way, so to speak, to the materialities I sent him. He never saw my script. He never saw any of the images, but I described and we had a conversation. So that was this other dimension, in a way. So what do you maybe refer to?
Do we have time for a few more questions?
Can I have a question about non-Euclidean space? How could you say a little bit more about that? To what extent are we talking about a space that's defined by hyperbolic geometry or other kinds of scientific ideas around non-Euclidean space? Is it purely in relationship to animation?
I don't know. I work on animation for quite a long time, and it's grounded in my PhD, so to speak, where I started to work on the Bergsonian notion of the image. So rather than being a representation, it's the image is a pure surface, so to speak. It's the virtual, the relation between the virtual and the actual. So what we see is an actual image. So it's an infinite possibility, so to speak. So it could animation, and one animation could be one image which just transforms into all kinds of other images, but remains one thing from the beginning. And I suppose this question of non-Euclidean touches a little bit upon that, but also I'm interested in this Asian idea of this, or the format of Asian images or pictures, so to speak, we are always immersed in it. It's flat. It's literally flat. And that kind of, again, establishes a kind of interesting connection, I would think, from the Western point to into this Asian understanding of the picture. Space.
I thought I should just move in.